I mean, dude, things do get changed up, especially when you get to like the main stage. We always say like the majors and TI have their own like in little small meta that starts getting created. And now we're seeing like the Shadow Demon Luna creating that type of meta. So that might influence these teams to change their drafts up just in a slight margin.
And that, I mean, that is always an intriguing question, is what have we seen established outside of the SD Luna? The trends that we thought we'd established in the group stage have already changed, Ben. Like, it means like we saw Magi be available and not picked. Like, the things we thought we knew have been scrapped, and it's the same tournament.
Yeah, and no Warlock too. I think Warlock. NP had like an extraordinary run with Warlock just in October.
And nothing's changed.
Yeah. No Venno either. Yeah, no, I was Venno. Pretty surprised there's literally zero Venno.
Yeah, what is the deal with that? Because that was like in the groups, it was pick Warlock win game, now it's pick Shadow Demon win game. Okay. I'd rather they pick Warlock. At least it's exciting to watch, for Christ's sake.
Three of the heroes that we talked about are switched up.
Oh, get wrecked.
And now, okay, first pick Omni Knight.
Interesting.
So NP did have very good. I think it was versus MVP. They played the Warlock or the Warlock Omni Knight combo, and it was extremely powerful.
It's too early for Santa hats. Take it off.
It's never too early for Santa hats. All right, maybe it. No, it's December. Come on.
It's close enough now.
Okay, December 8th.
You're humming Christmas songs downstairs.
Yeah, that's literally what we're singing. Although we're singing the Mariah Carey one.
Yeah.
So it happens. It's dark down there, y'all. It's anything can happen.
I like this opener a lot versus MP. Mm-hmm. The Warlock's out. I think Warlock Omni have kind of been their two heroes that I think they've been utilizing a lot recently that really haven't been touched too much by other teams.
Magi.
Magi Jug. Yeah, Jug, safe pick overall. Omni's actually a great matchup for Stead 2, so maybe they're expecting NP to go for that route.
So we've normally seen Bat and Ogre.
We're back to what we believed
but
in.
But we're back into this. Let's just hit the Bat, take the Ogre. Good solid heroes.
Yeah, Shadow Demon's solid. Banned, so we're back to our group stage heroes, yeah. That's for sure.
We'll get Warlock's banned, we'll get Jug.
He's kind of straightforward at this point.
Sounds like you're doing a Charlie impression or something over there.
Actually a very intriguing contrast to look at when you see no SD and immediately suddenly welcome back Batrider, welcome back Magi.
Yay.
NP do have to worry about playing too greedily. They were just talking about Pugna in the interview in eHome. They are one of the most successful teams with the Pugna, and they are mm-hmm. not scared to push you early on. Even not in this patch, they run Pugna a lot.
Yeah, and paired up with Omni Knight, it's always very good. Like, obviously, you have extra sustain, you have repel, so you can be the needed frontliner, not to have to worry about just getting bursted down quickly.
Mm-hmm.
And then they even have, like, the vision game with Batrider. They have, like, that initiator to kind of just throw the throw it off a little bit from NP.
Do you think that, I mean, Luna without SD, do you think she's still, like, worth picking?
For Sylar, yes. I think it's one of Sylar's best heroes. Sylar, I think, is like Weaver, Luna, Morphling, and Pugna, probably. Mm. Those are his best four heroes this patch.
Why haven't we seen much Morphling so far? Like, to me, Morphling is one of those heroes that too is slow. Super good, but too slow.
All these games have been like 20 to 30 minutes. A lot of them have been 20 to 30 minutes, and Morphling just doesn't have time to have his impact on the game.
There's a lot of grouping up as well. Like we saw in multiple series, we see like five-man units kind of running around. Morphling is not really... Of course, he can split push, but he can't really join your team fights in that manner. He can have a replicate with you and then join in with like that, but if he's alone, he's susceptible to ganking, and he just takes a long time. Mm-hmm. Needs like one or two, like two items even more than that to become a relevant force. NP... recognizing the kind of push thing that we're mentioning, they ban out the Luna and the Terrorblade. Sylar specialties for sure.
But Pugna.
But Pugna's still there.
I think Pugna's going to crop up. They seem to be quite happy with it. I mean, if we recap what he did say in the interview, Lanham.
They also ran Enigma at the group stage. Also a very unusual pick. I think I saw it banned once, but hasn't been picked.
Yeah, pretty much the only team that gets banned versus, Zhao 8 Team Elfly. Just because he loves the hero, and he works really well around it with his team. Rubick ban. I mean, that's just a stable hero. We've seen it in multiple different instances. Obviously, with an Omni Knight, you really want to get rid of that. The one thing that kind of, I feel maybe, I don't want to say deters Ehome from wanting to pick the Pugna, is just that Omni Knight, or Pugna already has a reason to be building Diffusal for Omni Knight, and Diffusal overall versus Pugna can be pretty solid, be able to remove the Crepify instantly.
Yep.
I'm just looking for the head-to-head. I believe these guys played recently.
Desperately They played at Beat It, right?
They played at Summit.
They played at Summit
they
as well.
They played at Summit, okay. Yeah, I found it. Okay, so yeah, it was a 2-0 to NP at the Summit. So head-to-head does go in favor of NP, albeit We did see a 50% odds on the desk. We saw we're close to that in the world of social media and in the crowd as well. I like that we did a crowd vote as well earlier on today. Weaver's back.
Kind of Weaver.
I was going to say, is this the question we find ourselves asking every time a Weaver is brought up? Is where does it go? And there's no Drow. Ho, ho, ho.
Yeah, there's no Drow, so more than likely it's going to be played in like a core role, and this Jug looks like he's probably more than likely going to be going in the mid lane.
Yeah, well, there's not that many good heroes versus the Batrider, but both of their cores are very solid versus the Batrider. You often see Weaver banned out as soon as the Batrider comes out in the first phase, especially because Oracle's kind of nowhere to be seen.
Yeah,
Vengeful Spirit, like none of the supports really counter Batrider anymore, so you have to pick a core that does well versus him in the lane.
And so when they start, I mean, they have Ehome have not showed their hand at all, right, Ben? Like, this has been, it's still very, very flexible.
Right now,
flexible.
Though, we should see...
I mean, you know it's an Omni support, right?
Yeah, obviously, but we should know whether or not they go for push or not.
Yeah, this will probably dictate it.
They were very well known for pushing with a Wisp early. It wasn't like the Wisp Tiny or Wisp CK that we've seen. It's just like Wisp Chen, Wisp Bristle, the ones that knock on your towers very early on. I wouldn't be too surprised to see them pick up Bristle. They like Bristle a lot. They run Bristle mid. I think they're the only team that does that.
Okay.
I don't think it's particularly good here.
But they could do it.
It's good if they want a hero to, like, that's up in front, they can hit towers. Or they could Pugna.
I mean, we'll learn a lot.
Is this when it would pop up if it was Pugna time?
Or fourth, maybe?
Okay. Yeah.
Not quite yet. Not ready yet.
There's no heroes that Pugna's like particularly good against. I guess they have a lot of physical damage, so you could defensively decrep, but that's like a very small thing in the grand scheme of things. Mm. Their anti-push is pretty weak, though.
Oh, that's a hero I was not expecting to see.
Wow, that was not at the tip of anyone's tongue.
Bane.
Mm. I was gonna like say maybe Disruptor just to have like that type of thing for the Weaver and more teamfight, but Bane, very lane-dominant hero. This is just gonna happen. Okay, so I was actually going to say when the Batrider was picked up from Ehome that NP probably wants something to counteract the vision game and be another like form of initiation. So this is also a very popular pick for NP. They were drafting it for MSS quite heavily. So it's not too much of a sucker to see this group this grabbed. And also it gives them more Roche potential and objective potential with these three high physical damage cores.
Interestingly enough, when these two teams last did play, NP found success. They actually won both of those games with Warlock, and that was one of the first things they chose to remove. Quite having it work for them in the past, very recently.
Do you suppose sometimes if you've had good success with a hero, you ban it against opponents because you think they will have figured this out. They will have spent some time researching it, and maybe even they'll try and get it themselves and steal our strat from under us. So you just think, just forget it. We'll ban it. We'll go with something else. Does that ever happen, do you think?
I think time to time, maybe they just didn't want to deal with, like, they didn't have first pick, maybe they thought Ehome would take it, so yeah, that kind of makes sense.
I'm gonna snatch it away.
Timbersaw could have issues. We saw earlier in this tournament just Juggernaut solo killing Timbersaw in lane, but overall, I don't really think they have good solutions for the Timbersaw. Not that much magic burst. Their lineup's like very heavily based around physical damage. Even with Bloodlust, they're gonna have issues, I think, with the Omni Knight involved, especially.
Absolutely. This is what we saw WG do that with the Omni Knight behind the Timbersaw. And there was nothing they could really do to kill that guy. He just had so much sustain and so much survivability.
And so it's time for, I mean, this is where I would suggest that we get those curveballs fogged, but I feel like you were already plenty surprised by Bane. Not going to necessarily influence the approach to the game too much.
I mean, Bane was a very interesting and good pick. Like, they didn't really have any ways to stop it, so it's just gives you a high amount of disable versus the Weaver. Hoddle banned out, so it looks like... I mean, it looks like they want to pressure really hard, right? Like, get up onto the... Just, like, get a couple stacks onto the... Get the Timbersaw, like early Bloodstone, and then just get going, just like they did with WG. Probably see them... I mean, they lack physical damage, though, right now, so they'll probably either go for the Pugna, like we've mentioned multiple times, or they go for some just, like, physical damage core that can knock at their doors early on.
Timbersaw has been such a constant presence in the draft. We haven't really addressed too much about Timber and what he does so well. Is it this flexible nature that we were talking about yesterday?
Yeah, he
why
does.
Why is he such commonplace in our drafts? I don't like him. Why?
He's just so beefy. He just stands in the front lines. We see it banned like first two a lot of the times. just like so much burst potential. He pretty much like, if you have no burst potential on your team, you pick a Timbersaw, it's like, oh, their team has burst potential now. Like, just
and
from
he
one hero.
Wins most of his lanes. I think the only melee hero he struggles versus is Ursa.
Yeah.
So he struggles a decent amount. Maybe Sand King a little bit, but Sand King's actually fallen off a decent amount too.
I mean, find a flaw then. I mean, you said that he basically wins lanes, he's got burst potential. Where's Timbersaw's
flaw? He can be countered by magic. A lot of the drafts have been like very physical based. We've seen like a lot of Sardar, even a lot of Weaver, Dazzle, and these heroes just have a lot of trouble killing Timbersaw. Juggernaut's okay because he has the burst and Omni Slash, but...
One of the approaches MP did specifically versus Timber, that was the game that they picked the Warlock Venomancer, and the Venno laned 1v1 versus the Timber and went just straight Gale and Poison. He didn't even get the wards, and that was it. Actually destroyed the Timber throughout the whole entire game. He wasn't even able to get online. This Lycan pickup though it's interesting. You know, a lot of people look at Lycan, they're like, it's a weak hero right now. It is, in concept. But with this type of lineup backing you up, it's very different. And he goes for a silencer.
Okay.
So they still don't really have great ways of dealing with the Timbersaw though. But they do have that potential of being able to get on him, burst him down, like just try to burst him down during the global silence with the roar and everything, but it's a tall order to ask for.
This is fun. So it does seem like you guys want to have the silencer explained to you, want to see the Lycan explained to you. And you feeling all comfortable in your predictions? I'm not seeing any smiles across the board.
I like Ehome's draft.
I like Ehome's draft.
Fan of Ehome. Okay. Well, we'll see if they can take this first game, Ehome.
Shut it down. You look way too smug.
Ted and I are Ehomies. Now we can
Ehomies. Let's do this.
Our homies, our casters are ready. We can bring them up. I believe we have Gods and Toby 1. Enjoy.
Well, I don't know about the Ehomies, but I'm here with Gods, and we are ready to cast what could be our longest game of the day. MP going up against Ehome, but we missed out on the beautiful Naga, not banned, not picked at all.
We won some long games. We talk about this series, like, this could go three games.
It could.
Panel, the viewers, everyone's kind of split as to who's actually got the advantage on this one. We've yet to see that elusive three-game series, but hopefully we get lucky here.
Everything has been a 2-0. It's been very clean and crisp so far. Made for very quick days, but of course, coming into this draft, we do see some interesting and different changes, even though with the history of these players, they're not that unusual. So seeing that Lycan, we've seen him once before already here in the playoffs, but also bringing in the Bane element for Ehome.
Yeah, so, definitely, that's one of the beauties about Ehome and Lion-M and his teams. They're never afraid to pick some of those more unconventional heroes, something that the coach 7-1 has always brought to the table. He goes back to coaching DK, now he's back with Ehome. He always is kind of pushing the limit as far as which heroes are actually viable, which are in the meta, which aren't. Why not pick something that isn't as common? The Pugna picks that we've seen here, it's something like a Bane, a first pick Omni Knight, when we're expecting something just like the classic Lunas and Nagas and things we're seeing. Do you fancy it for Jackie Mao?
Yeah. They're gonna have some fans. It's very, very rare we get to see a big Canadian flag thrown across the stage at an event.
That was something different. I was looked up at the stage and like, well, that's a big Canadian flag. That's right.
It's actually appropriate compared to the American flag of DC.
Careful, Toby.
For
now, we've got the crowd on our side.
Five non-American players. It's fine. We'll have a team fight and we'll be good as gold again. But it's actually interesting you brought up the Pugna pickup from Ehome to actually have that element of push. We were discussing it at the end of the Ehome's draft. How is Ehome actually going to win this? You saw their first four hero picks, and not a lot of it allowed you to go high ground with that final core. And then you get the Lycan pick up. This is kind of like that answer. If you can get that really great team fight, the question is, can you get through the laning phase?
Yeah, they were really lacking anything to hit buildings with until that last pick, and the Lycan solved that problem. They're still lacking a bit as far as the burst damage goes. The Timbersaw is the one hero that has to stay alive in the fights if they want to get kills. Like, you lasso someone, you grip someone, it's not going to kill them by itself. It's got to be Old Chicken coming through. We saw some great Timbersaw plays yesterday, especially coming out of WG Unity, and that's kind of the role Old Chicken's going to have to play. It's one of those scenarios where he may become more like the carry in some ways than others.
I'm going to curse him up. AUI can start with a little bit of a body block. Old 11 will walk out. He came in here as a harassment game up against Rose, and also to stop the initial ward placement from the silencer. Shikuchi, does AUI think he might even have this? Old 11 back behind the tower, but nope. Garter is there to hold his hand with the purification. The next question I have is, did Rose work out where that observer ward was placed? They did ping the Batrider, and yep, they did. So that's an early observer ward victory there for NP.
Yeah, nicely played. They also popped the initial TP mid of Old Lanham's Bane, so he tried to TP mid to get an Observer Ward down as well, and that got prevented. So the early smoke TPs, and it is NP with a slight vision advantage come early game.
Yeah, they'll be able to watch that top rune area and the rotation coming down from the top lane. And we'll see where Lanham wants to put, because he's still got sentries available as well as his one observer ward. So we'll see where Ehome believe the vision is most essential. And well, there goes one of the sentries, and it will hit absolutely nothing.
The big thing here with Ehome's draft and lane stage is they want to contest that offlane. They're sending the Omni Knight up top with Ult 11. We saw some similar things out of Newbie when they were doing the Io with the Batrider. And this is a dual lane that can be very potent. When you have a healer to help the Batrider dive for the kills, if he gets a few napalm stacks up, he can get very aggressive.
Now, I'm just loving this mid lane. The fact that you just say, oh, we're not going to run the safe lane like, and instead we put him into the mid lane, work around with the Bane, with Brain Sap. Their sustain is pretty good here in the mid. And that allows the Timbersaw to go one-on-one with the Beastmaster. Careful not to get kited out, but when MSS goes for Axes as opposed to Call of the Wild to start with, it's a lot easier for the lane for Timbersaw.
Yeah, Lycan as a hero is actually somewhat more suited to the mid lane rather than that safe lane. He just doesn't do anything to zone out off lanes, which is kind of what, if you want to run like a jewel or trial lane in the safe lane, you don't really want to be playing these carries that just hit creeps and don't zone at all. And that's where putting Syla in the mid lane, Ehome decide, makes more sense for them. And the 1v1 for the Timbersaw versus Beastmaster should be just fine for them. They're actually probably slightly happy that Old Chicken gets a 1v1 like this, although he's not going to win it on CS. It's not a lane where he can really die until Beastmaster gets 6 and has a teammate rotate in.
Not unless he can just push Beastmaster out of the lane with over-regression, that's another way. But it's top lane where MP are committing more of their players, as SVG was just thinking about a rotation up to top lane to help out. Rose has not had the easiest time of his life. Guard has been really messing up his pulls a lot. This gave a lot of space to Old 11 inside the lane, but with stick charges, AUI is going to be completely fine.
We'll see the Howl just being spammed out throughout the lane. Sage Syla wants to give all three lanes as much of an edge as possible, so giving that bonus damage to the Timber in his 1v1, to the Batrider up top, but still, no problems for MP as far as the lanes go. Very even laning stage if you look at kind of where the CS stands right now, and we'll see if there's going to be any breakouts. I kind of look towards that Batrider. Once he gets a few more levels, if he stacks up napalms, he's probably the player looking to get aggressive here in the laning stage. But similarly, Weaver and Silencer, they can get aggressive on the Batrider, and that's exactly what they're trying to do now.
Yeah, with the Scarabeetles down, AUY, he doesn't have another Shikuchi available, and they'll get rid of the bugs. Guard is always nearby. He was only stacking and looking at rune control for the 2 minutes, came back at the right time. So MP should have been ready for the support to arrive back. But it's just a lot of trade-off to start with in the laning phase. If not a lot more than that, burning of consumables. And once they start to dissipate, then we'll start seeing a bit more of an opening for potential kills.
Both teams really just testing the waters, like poking and prodding, like trying to harass, see how their opponents react. It's one of those kind of just, all right, you're in game one, you want to kind of just test how things are going to go, how aggressive are your opponents going to be. Especially in that old 11 offlane with the Batrider, we're seeing most of the aggression happened, but all 11 falls back, farms a double stack. He's now level 4, so he can heal up and go to that top lane fresh. He's going to have full HP, full mana, and this is where this top lane can get really problematic, especially for the support of Rose. He needs to be very careful about his positioning with a level 4 bat and the repel as well as purification up on Omni Knight.
Gives a lot more safety when you want to go for that initiation. Old Chicken's got himself a bit of a stack on the bottom lane, which has been denying up a little bit of the experience too. That's why MSS is not as happy. Middle lane, a little bit of a spin. Envy will be moving back out of this. Well, it's been a while since we've seen the crippling and feeble that is the Bane. And it's actually 2 points gone into it. So Lanham is really trying to restrict the farm of the Juggernaut. So far it hasn't worked. It's still 17-7. Up against this Lycan, which is 15-5.
Yeah, it should start to kick in a bit more now that it's level 2. That's 60 damage reduction. That's all of Jug's damage gone. Last thing just doesn't really become possible whatsoever at that point outside of using the Blade Fury, so
it's actually allowing the Bane to just have the mid lane. If Syla wants to rotate off, go find some runes, potentially just farm up a small camp. This gives Lanham some very early levels, and both SVG as well as Eternal Envy can't really zone him out of the lane. Huh?
I mean, he's in that mid lane, so he's got that
MSS
T1
bottom
mid tower,
lane. This may be the first blood as Old 11 rotates over, starts at the Firefly, needs a little bit more sticky napalm at MSS, starts his TP, Flame Break has no stunts, but Old 11 with 2 points up in the Whirling Death has just enough damage.
Great rotation. Old 11 realizing that MSS is vulnerable down there, had to get to the side shop to pick up his TP, and knew they had enough burst damage to get him before he could TP out. The TP is also on cooldown, so you look at this bottom lane, and it's a huge creep wave at the tower doing damage, and Beastmaster can't TP on down there. He's missing out on all of this farm as well as experience, and the tower is taking damage. This is A really nice first blood pickup by Yihome.
And then Old 11, even if you do get down there, he's now pulling that big stack, and this is good farm for the Batrider. So the Blink Dagger timing, after already having Triangle Boots, is looking very, very good for the Batrider.
Yeah, there was a period in time where Old 11 was kind of considered that top offlane player when Yihome were on top of the scene going into that Shanghai Major, but as it stands, Old 11 seems to be back in form. He's been very influential in this early game, pressuring the offlane, keeping the Silencer and the Weaver busy, now making the move down bottom, farming up these stacks. Doesn't actually manage to complete it because of all the magic resistance coming out from some of those smaller creeps, the Centaurs, which do die, but make it a bit more difficult to farm.
It's a problem when you're running this early Batrider rotation down and you went for the early point up in Flamebreak. Not as easy to farm, but while that was happening too, you had a small little smoke mission out from Old Lanham. Yeah. So we smoked up and put the Observer Ward right next to the Dire Secret Shop, as well as one inside the lane. So they're watching the maneuvering of MP around the mid lane and near the Ancients very, very closely.
These are good wards to actually scout out smokes as well, because often you'll smoke behind that Tier 1 mid tower and not expecting there to be a ward there. So when Beastmaster hits 6 and looks to make maybe perhaps his first move or two, these are the kind of wards that may actually reveal to you that Beastmaster is smoked up, trying to go and gank you.
And so Scyther is, again, moved down for Rune, slipping into the jungle.
This Batrider, Toby, he's got 2k gold. We're 6.5 minutes in. This is one of the fastest Blink Dagger timings I've ever seen. And this is with Trenkle's Windlace. He hasn't really skimped on the other item. And here we go, one more stack and he's got it.
The question is, where does he attack? Who can he attack? You've definitely hit the timing before AUI is going to have that Lincoln Sphere, obviously, because it's so early on. But with the support behind him from Rose?
It's not the easiest kill, but it is possible. You'd need perhaps a third hero. The Purification with the Heal Bomb gives you that little bit of extra damage as well. But with Time Lapse, yeah, you've got to burst him down before he actually uses that. So we'll see where he goes. He's probably calling for his teammates, one of the supports, like, hey, I've got this Blink. I can't get a kill on my own. You can actually come with me to make sure I've got the damage I need.
It's actually SVG. TP'd into the middle lane underneath the Observer Ward, but also smoked up. So NP Ehome understand that somebody did come here.
Yeah, that's the beauty of those nice aggressive wards.
Oh, that Observer Ward, they saw it. MP saw it. That one Dire Observer Ward scouted out Batrider. Now he walks straight under it. So they know it's a very early Blink Dagger, and they smoke on top of the Dire Observer Ward.
Yeah. Not going to go too much. Meanwhile, the Radiant Scan does scout out the movement of some of the NP heroes towards that top lane. Both teams making a similar move, so the nice thing for Ehome is, yeah, they're not going to get a kill off of this smoke, but they will get a tower. They brought in the numbers to make sure, but NP have essentially made the exact same move to top. Both teams smoke up, go for the safe lane tower, and there's not going to be a response from either side to defend these.
The only small difference is the fact that NP brought their entire team, where Ehome is still pretty much spread out, like they commit three heroes to bottom lane to push it, no massive ultimates, but MP, I suppose if you come this far, you keep on going. They're attacking to the tier 2 tower, trying to force a reaction out from Ehome.
Yep, it is level 2 Bloodlust as well as a point in the inner beast, so there's a lot of attack speed on this entire lineup, and that's going to give them a strong pushing force.
Ehome is not going to let this stand. So they TP onto the side. Yeah, they're scanning on the side, but they're not going to find anything just yet. An old chicken under the cover of Repel comes close to the tower, but it looks like they actually have to let it happen. The tier 1 and the tier 2 tower taken by MP. Now they mass TP into the mid to stop Scyther and Lanham from doing their thing. MP starts to spin, looking for that moment over on the Bane. He's still got the Nightmare of Armor. Old 11 here in the mid lane, 2 on the Blink Ward. Lasso dragging back MP. The Roar is on Bane, so there's no extra Nightmare. All Brains have to help out Ehome. And they have to back out. That was Ehome's first initiation with the Blink Dagger.
No. That's not the way you want to reveal it. And this is one of those games where you go back to what was the new build we saw Batrider start doing like 6 months ago, where you rush the drums. And it's games like this which kind of show why that drums rush became so powerful, because you hit this Blink Dagger timing and you can't find kills with it. He's Old 11's probably looking around the map like, alright, I got a 7-minute Blink, who can do damage? And not really anyone on his team outside of the Timbersaw can partner with him to do damage. Bane's maxing and feeble. There's only 1 point in Brain Sap. There's no real damage. Omni was level 4 at the time, so only had 2 points in Purification. Lycan doesn't have items, so there was no real hero to partner with him to do damage, so he wasn't really able to find kills with the Blink Dagger. The drums build makes you a bit more self-sufficient. You just go diving in, you get lots of stats, you get tankier, you can do some more damage just by running at your opponents, and this 7-minute Blink has not really been able to lead to much for Ehome just yet.
Now, the only upside is you can say at least the Batrider's progression is going to be nice through the game, but So far, not that effective, but we were looking to have something like this from Ehome, like a very farmed up Batrider. There's a lot of weight on his shoulders to get that perfect initiation in the mid game engagements, because that's what will allow Lycan to have his space and just push forward.
Yeah. See whether or not Ehome look to continue to make moves around that Batrider.
Envy's trying to take old chicken stack. Yeah. He's got a little bit of health from SVG right behind him, and well, old chicken's not going to let him have it. Instead, it's up on top lane with AUI sitting in the tree lines. Bane, even with all the space they gave to old Lanham in the mid lane, he doesn't have that Fiend's Grip available yet.
That's coming mid for a lasso, perhaps?
Blink lasso, he got it. He's going to drag back Rose and into the purification of Garda. Rose will definitely fall out from here.
I think old Levin's recognizing, like, as much as you want to kill Cores when you get that blink, they don't have the damage, they don't have the heroes to do it. So instead, he's like, okay, these supports are getting a bit greedy. You've got a silencer farming mid. Let's punish this. Let's just take the easy kill. We're actually ahead on farm. The top three net worth heroes all on that Ehome side, so they don't have to be killing the core heroes. And Vayne's skill build, the max Enfeeble, is going to work very well against that Weaver. Weaver's going to be almost useless in a team fight if he can't do right-click damage, so it's actually a very clever skill build coming out from Lanham on the Vayne. Even though he doesn't have that damage output of the Brain Sap or the heal, he doesn't really need it. Vayne, one of the tankiest supports out there, so he's just going to be able to keep himself alive by negating the damage output of NP.
Because you negate that damage, this gives even more space for old Chicken. He wants the Weaver to attack him then. Easier reactive armor charges up without taking so much damage.
Yeah, old Chicken's kind of, in some ways, going to function as the carry in the mid-game at least. Lycan's got the Vlads and all that, but he's going to be more the hero that after they've won a teamfight off of old Chicken's damage, he hits buildings, he takes Roche. He's much more single target focused in a team fight and takes a bit longer to actually get those kills, so it's good to see for Ehome that old chicken is getting good farm and very close to completing his Bloodstone.
Where are you off to, Sila? There's a smoke maneuver from NP. The Observer Ward's up on the hillside for only another 5 seconds, but it's enough time now. Sila can see his own demise being worn out on the top rune. He just came down there for that and gets really nothing for it. Nice blink away from old 11. Actually dodged almost a point blank Crypt Swarm from AUI. Back behind the tier 1 tower, old chicken's down, fresh sentry, just in case they can see him, because they'll scout out the observe wall that's got placed as well. So Bane will take care of this. Old chicken still waiting for the perfect time, under the cover of that invis rune, right on Envy. They start with the purification, now the lasso, also dragging Envy back behind the tower. He couldn't see it coming, and now tries to spin himself away, but the Fiend Strip is up. Envy is locked in position, AUI is trying to help him out. But with the GA, AUI knows there's no killing here. Has to one charge up, was a little bit worried about the tick damage coming out from the flame break. TP's all the way home, in fact.
And you find a key kill like that, and you've got a Lycan with Vlads on your team, you push buildings. This is going to be a tier 1 that NP cannot defend. Really nice jump coming out from Ehome, having the invis rune there, of course, playing to their advantage. And you have to worry that some of these other lanes are pushing in. They are missing out on some farm, but they're able to take the tier 1 mid while already TPing the Timbersaw down bottom to make sure that he can continue to complete that Bloodstone.
He's stopping MSS from getting too much space, and this is one of the heroes which can counter the Timbersaw nicely if MSS can get a little bit more farm up. Necrobooks are not a cheap item, and he's still going to combine it up with a Blink Dagger to get the proper initiation that MP wants from him. And this is not the greatest situation either. Starts his TP, Lanham, slowed up, can't even get inside the tree line. Old Chicken tries to remove it, but they don't get the vision in time.
A nice little escape. Beastmaster, still not at that Necro one. He's probably the hero that struggled the most out of this laning stage, and so much goes back to that one kill from the Batrider rotation, where MSS missed that big creep wave at his tower. He is sitting, as far as the six cores go, the one noticeably behind. He's just down there at 4k net worth, and this is a hero that does need to hit those good Necrobook timings in order to be a counter to the Timbersaw, as you mentioned, or to be able to kind of smoke with his team and push towers. He just doesn't have that items to fight with right now, and NP, not really a lineup that wants to sit back and try and farm, because that's where you get picked apart. If you play the farming split style of Dota, that's where Batrider can be the king.
They're grouping up again, Ehome, about to smoke in the mid lane, judging by their first initial movement, but then Garda went all the way home. He has a TP scroll to get back out, so okay, they're going to smoke up with old chicken timber chaining into it all. Nearest target they have is SVG, yeah, who's just walked up to the Radiant Shop. He's on a warding mission, he may have just dodged a bullet.
This is a better target for Ehome though, if they can get AUI.
Well, he's pushing the tower. In fact, now they look for the kill on Sylas. Starting up with the Ignite, Fire Blast to follow through. The Blink in, Lasso able to hit the target. Weaver dragged in. The Global Sylas trying to create a little bit of space, allows AUI just to time lapse off a little bit of damage into the tree line. Starts his TP. Is there a stun? Is there a control? No, there is not. It will be a good escape for MP, but the committal of the Global Sylas was the cost.
But Shikuchi TP means the Bane did not have vision to get the Fiend script off, but as you said, the global being used perhaps sets them up to take the top tier 1 tower E-Home. Have the tools they need up there if they want to bring the Lycan in to push it.
Envy, he actually walked straight past Old 11. He didn't see him, he went through the tree line, and now Rose is open. Old 11 flies a very wild flame break. Rose will still die. Envy had a potential early warning system because he walked on the other side of the tree line to Old 11. Now NP won a little bit more. They'll actually charge themselves forward. AUI, still no time left up, but with the Envy Omni Slash in, he'll go through Old 11. Now it's up to Old Chicken to punish him. Envy starts to spin TP. Leaves the rest of his teammates to get out. Because while all this happens, Lycan was pushing the top lane and took the tier 1 tower with Garda.
Yeah, losing a core hero, but I think ultimately finding the initial kill and creating the space for Syla to take a tower and to take control of this top lane as well as top jungle is at least a small win for E-Home. They are maintaining their slight lead, even with the Batrider casualty. And again, it's NP who always have to commit these. It's an Omni Slash or a Global Silence just to save someone. NP are using their big ultimates, and anytime they do, E-Home immediately pushed forward because Lycan doesn't really have that downtime. Even without Shapeshift, and he hasn't been using Shapeshift, he can still continue and sustain his push just by having the Wolves and the Vlads.
And with all the farm he's managed to get so far, like Syla is rapidly approaching his own Necrobooks. And they look for an opening. Blink Lasso is over on the Beastmaster thanks to the Arcane Rune. Syla is very happy to trigger off that dog form, chasing up after MSS, finds the kill. And E-Home arriving in force. The only one who's not there is Garda, who's up on top lane trying to complete this mech. They need that if they want to go high ground.
Yeah, they're not in a huge rush to go high ground, but they will be looking around that first Aegis perhaps to threaten and force NP to make some kind of defense. But they still got a few tier 2 towers to work on, as well as perhaps thinking more towards the level 2 and level 3 Necrobook of the Lycan as kind of their peak as far as being able to push. That's going to be more their timing than right now. Right now they're kind of in that pick-off stage. Find a pick-off, take an outer tower. They're not thinking high ground quite yet.
Don't give it time. MP need to find some kills, delay this style of push from E-Home. If they start losing all their tier 2 towers and all their out-of-map control, 5,000 gold advantage we just saw for E-Home is going to start to rise. And MP done a pretty good job of finding farm for their cause. Of course, the sacrifice is to their offlane and their 3 position. But Envy is pretty close behind the Lycan.
Yeah, Envy's doing well. He's got 2.5k gold, close to completing a Mant Stealth he wants. And AUI's close to the Lincolns, but no Dragon Lance, no Diffusal, no other kind of damage items. The straight Lincolns is almost a necessity against the bat, but it doesn't give you any damage output.
It's MP's turn. They just smoked on top of a Radiant Observe Ward in the mid lane. No Sentry Ward being planted down beforehand, so E-Home, if they want to dodge, they can do so. There's Observer Wards up on the hillside near Roshan. Sylas keeping the Lycan Wolves just a little bit further to
they
the
scan,
left,
they
so they can see the Hawk coming in. And now MSS starts with a roar, Necrobooks are up, and they actually hold him! The Nightmare cancelling off EE's ulti, Omni Slash massively ineffective. Now the Guardian Angel as well in the Fiend Strip, keeping Envy in position. They're just controlling up the biggest net worth of MP, and that's the Juggernaut. Sylas has already gone down, they're fighting inside the Firefly. Sylas has himself a double kill, and Envy's on the run. The dog, or actually his Old Chicken, chains over the Chakra, slows him down. Whirling Death's available, but of course EE spin back off cooldown, TP's away to safety, so they lose the fight, and now they'll lose Roshan.
E-Home knew exactly what was coming. They scanned the rotation through that jungle, up that pathway. They were ready for that one. Could have been a bit dicey for them if they didn't get that Nightmare off on the Omni Slash. If that Global Silence came in before that Nightmare, they maybe killed the Timbersaw then. If they get that Timbersaw, that fight does not go as well as it did for E-Home. But even so, it was a well-prepared, well-positioned fight, and E-Home come out on top. They get Roshan as a reward, and also a nice kind of chunk of gold, which is going to help Syla get up to the Necro 2 and almost the Necro 3.
Man, this is also so smart from Lanham. Like, I know I wanted to see his Rubik play today, and we do have more games for E-Home to play, but just that presence of mind to start with the Nightmare, to know that Global is coming, don't just go directly into Fiends. Just a great combination of abilities, and then he waited it out, still had the greatest position. NP couldn't capitalize on this EE initiation. There was no one that was close enough behind them. Like, the Beastmaster roars, and he's like, I got a solo target. Let's kill this guy, and we move on to the next one. Just didn't happen.
I can imagine, like, you just love watching this guy, and he's always exciting to see. Just from his skill build as a Bane, it's like not a hero you normally get excited about, but going for the max Enfeeble. Now he's gone back inside to level up stats. He says, who needs Brain Sap, Nightmare, any of these other spells? My job is mostly just to make the Weaver useless. Talk about Weaver having no damage items. He's going to lose 120 damage to the Enfeeble. That's like 90% of his damage gone from one spell. This is not an ultimate. This is just Weaver made useless. The Swarm is, of course, there. Does a little bit of damage, but not a whole lot. Shikuchi magic damage is kind of laughable if you're talking out of Weaver, and that's as his only damage output in a fight, so...
It's actually when you hope the Lincoln Sphere blocked Enfeeble, and this is not a situation or a phrase that I thought I'd be saying during the major.
Yeah, normally it's like, oh, you use the Enfeeble to break the Lincoln so you can grip the Weaver, but no, if anything, you kind of just Enfeeble the Weaver, then ignore him. You don't need to grip him if he's Enfeebled. He's useless. He's a ranged creep at that point, if that.
Chicken? Just moving his arms around, Lotus Orb is completed on him nice and early.
Oh, that's so good against the Silence and the Roar.
And he's so far up, like he's still walking around with a Bloodstone with 14 charges and the Aegis and 17 one charges. And Ehome, I said they wanted the mech to push high ground, they've got a lot more than just the mech.
Necro 3, this is the biggest timing perhaps for Ehome. Necro 3, mech, levels on the Omni Knight, so he's almost got the max repel. Level 3 is going to be good enough for them, and they're going to force NP to make a very difficult high ground defense.
Well, we thought we might have had a long game, but right now it looks like this is all in Ehome's side of the court. NP, they must defend this. The smoke up, MB and MSS trying to loop around the backside of Ehome and pincer in the team if they can do it. The Rax has already gone down. They want the fight. MSS roars in. Global Silence, the only sign, not enough. They focus down the Bane, but it's not in. There goes your GA. They don't have the damage output. Even with the purification of brains, that Bane's up to half life again. NP, for all their initiation, have done no damage, and now we'll start losing heroes. SVG will drop. The Bane did eventually die. But it's a one-for-one trade-off. You've still lost your melee Rax.
Finding that window where you just got the Necro 3.
Look at Envy, he just bails out. He's taking the tier 1 tower in mid lane as the only way he can see a way to stop this Ehome push.
That is brutal. Taking it, I mean, they already got the melee Rax. If anything, Ehome's like, we can ignore that range Rax and now go for another side lane once the Bane's back. Bane now has a gem as well to go with this team. So then they get harder and harder to make defense, and having that Lotus Orb to be able to purge off the Global Silence on one hero makes such a big difference in these fights. You can throw it on an Omni Knight to make sure he can get off something like a Guardian Angel. But Omni's not even going to need, he's going to have Greaves. He's just 120 gold short of Greaves, so then he's not scared of the Global Silence. And once you take that Global Silence away, MP's teamfight starts to look very lackluster.
They need something more, they need more damage. AUI's Deso might be able to help. You almost need MSS to have the Blink Dagger up and running instead of having his level 3 Necropook so they get that proper jump.
Yeah, ideally,
but then someone's gonna jump with him.
He wants to jump like the Omni Knight, burst him down to take his spells out, but tough kill to get when there's a Lotus Orb.
Yeah. And I'm also looking over towards Eternal Envy. What is he turning this glove into?
Maelstrom.
Maelstrom?
Not Midas. I hope not Midas.
Yeah,
it's gonna be a Maelstrom, I've got to imagine, just for that deep push factor. And being able to push out waves. It's kind of like the poor man's Battle Fury in some ways.
Well, it's a sad state. It's a state for NP, Ehome. Now, coming into the bottom, the Blink Lance, so perfect. Is there again? They got the Silencer. The Global Silencer was still on cooldown, so that didn't matter as much. But there's still one hero dead, making this a 5-on-4. You've got MSS waiting for that maneuver around the back. He does have level 3 Necrobooks up as Syla keeps his push going with his own Necrobooks. These things will time out in just a bit. And now MSS, the Roar is out with the Necrobooks. They have the Silencer back with the Global Silencer up. Batrider protected by the Nightmare. The Sun's on the Timbersaw. But again, MP, they initiate with stuns, but there's no damage. In fact, it's Ehome with a Fiend Script to keep MSS out. SVG dying in the tree lines. He's locked in and can't go anywhere thanks to Sharkram that's just seeing that Garner is low and he may go down finally. Yes, the Weaver can find a kill but lose his life instantly after. MP, they're dropping like flies at the moment. They can maybe buy back someone. The Weaver is the only one who's got it. Envy with the spin, doing some damage. The 4-star's up from old 11. He's got the distance. He's also got the gem, but he's also got a blink away from Envy. Oh, Chicken, whirl him down. Nothing but death. And MP, Well, Old Chicken's going to temper chain himself back in again. Is he really thinking this fight's going to continue?
I mean, he can 1v2 those guys. He cannot be killed by a Weaver and a Silencer at this point, but they don't get the melee racks. They are repelled off by NP, but boy, was that an expensive hold. Multiple buybacks used, both Weaver and Silencer. Ehome lose next to nothing. The Lotus Orb usage, again, to talk about Old Chicken in that fight. First, he uses it on the Bane, who then Nightmares to help save the bat. The second Lotus Orb comes out to help the Omnat. He's using it very selflessly. He's not afraid to put it on cooldown to help out a teammate and not have it for himself because he knows how tanky he is with the reactive armor. And Ehome are very close to breaking NP. If they get that second lane of racks down bottom, this game suddenly becomes very difficult to win. Damn near impossible.
And it really won't take that long. With all the negative damage which we've been talking about from the Bane, you're getting a Shiva's Guard almost up for Old Chicken. The Lycan is only a little bit away from completing up his full AC. So combining these two things together, and just the confidence as well, like, okay, do you need a BKB over on the Lycan to maybe deal with everything that MP throws at you? Nope. He's got teammates. He's got the Omni Knight. He's got great support from the rest of his teammates, and they're looking to go again. Bottom lane, SVG out just a little bit too far. They start with the Yulsef. The old 11's actually not even expending his lasso because he knows he doesn't need it. The purification damage is just too much. And SVG dies in the bot lane and dead for full 30 seconds.
Yeah, good control knowing that he didn't need the lasso. And in talk about AC, Silent knows his job is to hit buildings. And to do so, let's get an item that's going to give you attack speed and the minus armor. He's looking to just fulfill his role in this draft. And Ehome cannot be stopped. There's no defense from NP. They are letting this Rex go. They're just looking to get farm elsewhere on the map.
Until you've got the Weaver, like the Weaver is now 200 gold away from completing up the Desolator. The tier 2 towers on the top lane, they may have thought they had more time, but Ehome, they know they've got the control of this game. They're going for the GG push. It is time to fight. They have to come back. AUI is actually building a Diffuser Blade, selling up as much as he can, so he's got this available and the Lincoln Sphere, and now NP. All ultis are up. This is it. This is the moment. Either you repel Ehome or you tap out. A tier 4 tower will drop. Rose just pushing himself a little bit further forward with the Arcane Curse.
Looks like Ehome just wanted to retreat, reset, wait for the Necrobooks to come back up.
If he doesn't want to wait for it, he keeps moving forward, but the Necrobooks burning him down.
And you can see Old Chicken, he knows he is going to be the gatekeeper. If you want to get to Ehome and fight them, you've got to go through Old Chicken first. He's on the front lines with 20 Bloodstone charges, a Lotus Orb, and even if you go on him and use everything to kill him, he's going to instantly respawn, and suddenly you've got a 5v5 fight where you've used all your big spells to kill a Timbersaw. There is no way NP can approach a team fight by trying to go in the Timbersaw first.
Yeah, this is just an amazing game for Ehome. So clean, so efficient. And really taking advantage of the weaknesses in MP's draft. The silencer becomes a non-factor. MSS got shut down so much that his initiation is now almost useless. Even if he jumps on the timber, it's going to do nothing. So they just push. It's wonderful from an Ehome perspective. And MP needs something to get them back into this game.
Looking for getting a good initiation here, Toby.
Now blink up. There's your global silence. Rose will stop the lasso from happening. The Timbersaw is probably the most isolated. MSS just runs all the way up. They're focusing and running deep on the Omni Knight. Where is this damage? Well, the Omni Knight's guard is almost down. Makes it into the tree line. They don't find the kill. The Fiend Strip holds AUI in position. Envy will find one kill, but it's an Omni Knight. That's all he kills. And in the meantime, the rest of his team are pushing up the daisies. SVG is with him. Sounds on the Batrider, but Ehome, they smell blood in the water and they're circling like sharks. SVG will die. Old Chicken will take care of that. The question is, does Envy go with him? Maybe that question doesn't even matter.
Silent,
they're TPing to the tier 3 towers. They're taking it, and GG, not even 30 minutes on the clock, and Ehome takes game one against NP.
I mean, just very well executed strategy there. I mean, you can see it at the end. I mean, four heroes chasing NP. The one that's not, it's Sylar on the Lycan. He's like, all right, I'm going to keep hitting buildings. That's why I got to play Lycan today. And we get to see a Lycan win as Ehome take game one. Gotta imagine MP are gonna have a plan B, but this was a very tough loss for them.
Well, you can see Envy straight after the game, back to the sheets, back to those drafting sheets. They've got to think about how they get back.